problematic issues here. That's why we find that basically because of this banking system, yeah, everybody having a problems of cannot pay the debt with the interest, the burden of interest. But if you do complementary currency, we use all the resources without using money, we just exchange so that the resources are not wasted. Yeah, people who are able to work, even though they are in the real economy, they don't work, but people they are willing to work, they are working. But not exchange with money, but exchange with resources. So you see that it's closing the gap. Yeah, between of the wasting resources and also the wants, the desire, yeah, of our human beings. So we find that this is very good for community.
Malaysia, because
to know whether people is going to use it, you use this model, thumb model. Yeah. Okay. And then for the belief variable, we have two cognitive belief. One is perceived usefulness and perceived ease. Because we assume that if this orang asing find that this currency is easy to use, they will use it. Yeah. And the other one, if they believe that it is useful, they will use it. So there are two variables in this method. So I give you a figures how it's actually developed. So basically, we assume. Okay, so basically we are trying to do some analysis on the hypothesis whether there is a relationship between these variables. Yeah. Okay, for example, perceived usefulness might affect the attitude of using this currency, and then from attitude they will have intention to use. Then they will finally use it. Yeah, so this is called thumb model. And it could be also perceived ease to use. If they find that it's very easy to use, they will also be able to use this model. So this is a thumb model, and we have a hypothesis. Arrow will give us the hypothesis, yeah? Whether they are positive related or not. Yeah? So basically, this is the idea of thumb model. It's actually adopted from DRT. Okay, so first what we do is that these are the research questions that we ask. What are the main constructs that affect the orasic intention to use this model? And then the degree of strength. Okay, for the arrows just now, we also calculate what is the degree of strength, okay, of the relationship between the construct of variables. And we want to know also whether this is significant or not. Yeah. So therefore, we develop five hypotheses. Yeah. If there, we assume that there might be a positive and significant relationship between perceived usefulness and intention to use the model. And then second hypothesis, between perceived usefulness and attitude to use the model. Yeah. Okay. All this construct is actually taken from the survey question. Yeah. They developed from the latent. Yeah. So we also have hypothesis number 3, there is a positive relationship between perceived easy to use and also the attitude to use. Okay, between attitude and behavioral intention, and lastly between perceived usefulness and perceived easy to use. Yeah. So we assume that all the arrows just now, they are all the hypotheses. Yeah. Okay, and let's go through the finding. Okay, I can just go through the analysis. Very descriptively. Okay, descriptively we find that most of the poor orang asing are cited in Kelantan. You know, Kelantan is a very poor state, yeah, in Malaysia. Okay, I want to say among them they are very poor, yeah. And we find that the you a good result. So this is very important in this session. So this is all about the PI and attitude. Yeah. So we came up with the final structure, yeah, with a very good result. And from here, we transform into this hypothesis and also the test value. And we find that hypothesis one is significant. Yeah. In other words, means that there is a significant relationship between IIU and PI. Okay, we need to see that if this group of people find that this model is useful, they have intention to use it. Yeah? So we find it significant with a p-value is the probability 0.0. Yeah? So we need to see that the hypothesis, the null hypothesis is where this positive relationship is not there, is rejected. Yeah? Mm-hmm. So therefore there is a positive relationship. So all are significant. Find that basically the idea of having this complementary currency is actually having a positive what we call it response by this group. Yeah? So especially the agriculture, the use of agricultural goods. Yeah? Yeah. But we do also regression, logic regression. Logic means to tell us the probability that this group of people is going to use the model or not. Okay, using this logic regression, our dependent variable is binary. Binary means 1, 0. Yeah, 1 is opt for the currency, choose the currency. 0, not choose the currency. So it's again from the survey data. We ask whether you want to use the currency or not. Yeah, so they will just take whether it's yes or no. So yes is 1, no is 0. Okay, so for the dependent variable. And for the independent variable, we have many gender, dummy for gender, male and female, age, yeah. We also have family size and also other dummy variables that we ask in the patient. And we find that the one which is significant is family size, yeah. You look at the star there, yeah. The one with the star is a significant. So we need to say that those who have small family size, they tend to opt for the model. To the bigger size family. Yeah? So probably because it's easy to control, I think. Yeah, easy to control. With a big family sometimes it's not easy to control this activity or family activity using the complementary currency. And we find also that those who say that they have high probability to opt for this model, they are the ones that choose agriculture product. Compared to other, yeah, they are also unused tools. Some of them select unused tools, but if you look at the coefficient, the agricultural product is much bigger. So we need to say for those who are opting for the model, they are the one that opt for the agricultural product, and most of them also say that they will opt for this model if the complementary currency is also backed by national currency. We need to say. They want to be safe, yeah? So that this complementary currency must also have a value which is backed by ringgit, yeah? So this is also another finding that we find. And we also find that most of the time that people who opt for the currency are from the higher income group, yeah? This is shown by here. Okay, the last row there is a 3-star there. Higher income group, and also those who find that this complementary currency will benefit them and also their family. If it benefit them, they will opt for this. Yeah? Okay, and we also do some testing on this regression, and these are all the testing, because every time you do the regression, you must have diagnosis tests, yeah? To know your model good or not. So we find that this model are good based on the percentage of correct classification, about 88%. It's just like R squared, yeah? Okay, you can also use COG and L R squared there. Yeah? So it's between 53% to 71% the model is correct, good, yeah? And also other statistics. So these are all the diagnostic tests that we have to do when we do the regression. So what I can conclude is basically, find that agricultural product is chosen as a suitable comparison. high among those who are having small family and those who are having higher income. Yeah, and those who find that this CC is benefit them also their family, as well as for those who think that it must be back up in the national government. Yeah, so these are the conclusion that we have made from the research. Yeah, so this is one research that we do that using the survey data now. Yeah, so I have another research number two that is going to be presented here, which is using secondary data. Probably most of you find that this is much more interesting, because it's telling us that how to deal with small sample data, especially economics data. We talk about economics data. You only can collect data yearly data. You cannot get quarterly. You cannot get monthly data, right? So you got this problem of small sample data. We are applying a new method here, a method of co-integration test. Okay, I think this is day three. I'm going to present also the research methodology. Yeah, how to do the regression. So you can come. Yeah, that will tell you that how to do time series analysis. Okay, and this research are basically to cater this. Okay, as the topic is on digital development and also economic growth in Malaysia. Okay, and it's been presented in one of the conferences, and basically we are using co-integration test. The co-integration test, but using small sample, and use ARDL. Auto-regressive distributed lab model, but the critical value we calculate by ourselves. Yeah, because you cannot use the critical value which is provided in the table by Pusaran and Shin before. Use Pusaran and Shin Narayan. Yeah, they have their critical value, but their sample is very big. But for this purpose, we create our own critical value. Yeah, critical value to do the test. So let's look at the introduction. On this topic, basically we talk about digital development. We know that every country are now talking about digital development, right? Okay, people are having growing in using of smartphone, internet, application. Everybody, in fact, Indonesia also very, very fast. Okay, and you are hit ahead of using all this fintech. Yeah, I noticed that you are very good in financial technology. This is an example of digital development that we have. Okay, because of the rapid growing of the internet, and handphones, etc. We call it digital revolution. And we want to know whether this digital development contributes to GDP or not, growth, economic growth of the country. It's just that, a very simple relationship that we want to do the testing. Okay, but the problem is that we have small sample. Okay, and the objective is this, to analyze the relationship between digital development and economic growth, and we try to examine the short and long run relationship. Okay, this is normal in co-integration test. When we say co-integration test, we want to know the relationship short run and long run. Are they having relationship or not? Significant or not? Yeah? So that's the purpose of co-integration test. Right? And then we try to propose after that the policy. Okay, so then we go back to the theory of growth. Okay, we learn growth model, right? Yeah, growth model, which is basically classical theory of growth, says that okay, economic growth is determined by very important factor, labor and capital. That's basic, yeah? We call it growth model. But later on, with the new classical development, theory of growth, they came up with another variable, technology, FA, that. So that's the second equation, We call it endogenous theory of growth. And later on, Lucas, Barrow came up with new variables, FA, that contribute to growth. One of it is human capital, capital AC. We also have technology, capital, and labor. Yeah. So in this case, we're going to use this model, by adding the what we call it digital development variable. Yeah. So this result, yeah, on this relationship. In some countries, we find that digital economy, digital development contribute to the growth. But in many studies, they have to go through many channels sometimes. Okay, when we have digital development, it will affect productivity first, and then growth. They are also finding that, says that actually digital development will give impact on labor or productivity. Later on, it will be on GDP. So many studies that some they find no relationship, short run or long run, yeah. So we find that whatever studies that we find, there are also few that say that digital development must come up with the human capital together sometimes, yeah. You need human capital as well as an ICT, for example, in order to have growth, have productivity. So whatever it is, there are mixed results. Yeah, we want to know that. How the result of this digital development, the economic growth in Malaysia, right? Particularly in developing country, and one of the countries here is Malaysia. And these are the very simple hypotheses. Number one, digital development does or does not affect economic growth in short, right? And second, whether the digital development does or does not affect the GDP in the long run. We want to test short run and long run. Only the two tests, yeah? And these are the data that we collect, very small data. If you look at the variables, the data is selected from, the data and the variables are basically from the published data, World Bank. You can easily get from the website, yeah? But sometimes the data, some data is not available, yeah? And that's a problem. So if you also find the same thing, okay. And to get data nowadays, you have sometimes to have to pay for the data. So that's another concern, especially when you are student. Yeah? You can't afford to pay, yeah? Because sometimes it's $1,000 or $2,000 that you have to pay in order to get data. Okay, so our data is a very simple data. We just need GDP, real GDP, that's the first one, for the left-hand side variable, yeah? Left-hand side variable. We need capital, we use gross fixed capital formation. Labor force participation rate for the labor, yeah, labor force participation rate. And for the digital variable, we use two. But we cannot run both at the same regression, we do one by one, yeah. That's why we came up with model one and model two. Model one using mobile cellular subscription, and the other one is using broadband. Fixed broadband subscription. Yeah? And you see the data is very small. The first one is only 30 years. Yeah? 30 years. The second one is even small, 15 years. Okay? Because when you want to do a regression, all data must be available for all four data must be available. Yeah? So in this case, you're only able to get 30 data for model one using MOB, mobile cellular subscription. But the second one, only 15 years. So, but then we find that you can still do the regression, fact, is one of my lecturers when I do my PhD in Sheffield. Yeah? He came up with a calculation of critical value. To provide a formula, yeah, to calculate the critical value using whatever sample that you have. How many samples that you have. So this is very good. We call it response surface. Formula, if I'm mistaken, is given here, and this is the formula. positively, meaning to say that in Malaysia, digital arrival development, okay, can affect economic growth in the long run. Beside capital, and we found that labor is not find that in the long run, digital development is actually contributing to GDP, for Malaysia. But in the short run, we find opposite, negative relationship. Significant but negative. So we came up with the conclusion is basically, in a very short run, why is not contribute positively to the GDP? Because when you want to have digital development, you need money. You need national income to use to do infrastructure of the digital development. So basically the relationship must be negative. Okay, but in the long term it might contribute positive to the economy. So these are the idea of this testing. Yeah? So it seems that even though we have small sample, our findings are still significant. But the critical value must be very different to when you do the calculation, yeah? Because otherwise your regression or your model might having a sample of problems of misspecification or spurious result. So this is very important when we talk about econometric analysis, right? So when you do the testing also, you see that our testing is also find that the model is good, especially F statistic is significant. We also have no problems of normality test. Normality distribution, jangka merah is a test for normality distribution of error. We also do not have a problems of heteroclasticity. Yeah, in econometric, you have to test that. We also don't have a problems of serial correlation. LM test is for serial correlation. So every time we do the testing, we need to have this testing, yeah, in order to know whether model is good or not, yeah? So most importantly is the ECT, error correction term. Okay, this model, why is very important? ARPL, why is good? Because we combine short run and long run. ECT term is actually telling us when the variable, the dependent variable far away from equilibrium, how fast they come back to the equilibrium. Yeah, the ECT error correction term, the coefficient there, you must have negative coefficient and significant. Otherwise, you cannot say there is a long run relation. Yeah? And this speed of adjustment is about 67%, 68 or 67%, 0.679. Yeah? Meaning to say that when the variable, the GDP variable, deviates from the equilibrium, it will turn back the equilibrium about 68%, very quite fast, because the range must be between 0 and 100, yeah, the speed of adjustment. In this case, it's about 67% or 68%, it's quite fast, more than 50%, yeah. So it's telling us that again, our long run model is quite good, yeah. Tell us that it can be reliable, our model. So we find that this is very inconsistent with, before this, there is no study that tried to do this calculation. But we find that our digital variable in the short run is negative and significant, which is claimed by many studies before that they are positive. So we find that actually in the short run is a negative, very opposite. Many studies, there are about two studies, have found that we have a positive relationship of ICT and income in the short run. But we found it's opposite. And ours is also significant. And the significant is only in the long run. Positive is only existed in the long run. Yeah? So these are the findings that we have. And basically, as I mentioned, our conversion, yeah? We call it conversion. The speed of adjustment is conversion rate is quite high. It's about 68%. And we also have no problems of heteroclasticity and also normality of our error system as serial correlation. So basically we find that the model is good and it also can cater very other methods of analysis. Especially for example in finance, for those in finance, because you have a very frequent data, very big data, you can get sometimes daily data, okay, probably you can opt for a better model beside for integration test. Gauss model or Arch model that capture volatility of the financial variable. And in fact, this test also can be done if you've got small sample, on financial variable. Because sometimes when we talk about Islamic economics, it's very finance, your data are still very limited. So you might need to use this method in order to came up with something which is beneficial and also interesting. Most importantly, to get significant results. So this is very important for research. So in research, these are the things that you normally do. So you can use secondary data, you can also use primary data. So this is a comparison of secondary and primary data. So I experienced both. But I found that to do your research very fast, normally you do secondary, you use secondary data. Because primary data takes a long way to go. Take months, sometimes years. People doing PhD using secondary data is faster compared to the one that using primary data. Okay, years for you to complete, for example, the whole data and to do the analysis. But it says that the good thing about primary data is you can have many things. You can put anything in the data because it belongs to you. You can do anything. You can do it descriptively. You can do cross-section analysis. In fact, there are some people that are doing what they call impact study, longitude study. They study, they do the data survey a few years. After 1 year or after 5 years, every 5 years. This is also another good thing. People are doing impact study on this. But for research, basically, we have to do both. Because you have to publish. As academician, experience become a lecturer, sometimes you have to publish very fast. So this is where you need secondary data. But to have grant, research grant, you can opt for primary data. But to publish is quite late, because it takes time. Okay? So in other words, means you must experience both. Then you know that how beautiful this research is. Otherwise, you cannot experience it. I know it's very difficult. When I did my first work, I got a grant of 100-something thousand doing on corruption. You know how difficult it is? I just thought that this is my second thesis, just like my second PhD. That my first research I did after my PhD, doing primary data, survey data. It's not easy. You have to approach the respondent. Sometimes you get a response, sometimes you don't get. You send 100 questions, you just have 10 questions back. Imagine that, you're wasting a lot of papers. And I also hire some curators to do it. But you know what happened? Sometimes the students are being treated but not nicely by this one. So you have to go and help them. That's very difficult, But you will appreciate it, actually. When you do the research doing the survey data, it will be much, much more interesting. You get a lot of experience, alright? It's just that you need a hard time. So, finish your PhD doesn't mean that it's end of the world. You are just started to do research. You are just undergraduate, right? Finish your project. Don't think that it's done, because knowledge is no bound, right? I think this is knowledge of Alpha, remember that. It tries to get more, because research is to solve the problem, You do research with the problem statement, with the hypothesis. The reason is to help what happened, the problem that we have in the society. even services that